here, you can see the most spectacular view of Dreamflux Reef.
A black hole? No. An accretion disk formed from consolidated memoria? Was Dreamflux Reef built on such unstable memoria?
Oh, so Mr. Yang is also versed in memoria dynamics. I was just trying to figure out how to explain this huge hole to everyone. I bet you guys have a lot in common with Miss Kami. In another 10 system hours, the above dream will swallow the dream below. My hypothesis was correct. This place will cease to exist as the dream devours everything. Who are you all, and why haven't you left yet? This place is about to disappear. I'm Kami, a dreamscape surveyor specializing in memoria dynamics, and this is my life's work that I'm researching. See that huge gaping hole? It was just a narrow rift many years ago, but now it's grown into a giant hole. The surrounding memoria has been flowing towards the other end of the hole at a constant velocity, slowly but surely. But the scary part is, according to my calculations, the flow rate of memoria has recently changed, and it's faster than ever before. It's almost as if something is sucking it in from the other side. By constantly improving upon Madame Rosalina's memoria measurement method, I've finally obtained accurate results. After 10 system hours, the Dreamflux Reef will cease to exist! Just like the melting of glaciers, everything will crumble and disintegrate! The dreams on that side of the void will fuse into one!
Please don't worry. This sort of thing has happened many times before. Miss Kami isn't a bad person. She's just a bit lost in her own world. She'll probably realize she's wrong soon enough.
You don't say. There was something else that piqued my interest. Who is Madame Rosalina?
Oh, do you know her too? Or are you also a fan of Memoria Dynamics?
We're very interested in Madame Rosalina's achievements. Could you tell us a little more about them?
Why, of course! She's an excellent scholar of Memoria Dynamics, and the first person to apply Memoria Rate Measurement Methodology on interstellar travelers. Regrettably, due to the presence of the Garden of Recollection, ordinary people don't pay much attention to the nature of Memoria. She departed this world without much fame, leaving only a few thin journals behind. I came to Pentaconi to learn more about my idol, and went to great lengths to seek out Dreamflux Reef, all because this is her final resting place. Prodigies always meet their demise prematurely. If only Madame Rosalina had more time, she would have discovered a way to reverse the flow of Memoria. I felt it. The source is in the Golden Hour. There is a certain anomalous presence stirring the currents of the memory zone. I must uncover more concrete proof. I must convince everyone.
Does the name Madame Rosalina sound familiar to you? That's right. It seems like she did a great deal of research and calculations in Dreamflux Reef before abruptly passing away.
Miss Kami regularly mentions her. I hear Madame Rosalina passed away during the prison war. She could see the Pentaconi of today. It's people building homes in the memory zone. I bet she'd be really happy.
Perhaps.
Our destination is the commercial district. That's where the largest crowds gather in Dreamflux Reef.
We might be able to find the others there.
Afterlife. This is Dreamflux Reef.
That's right. Did you hear that? Repeat after me. Dreamflux Reef.
You're talking to someone invisible. If I'm not dead, what am I? I shouldn't have pushed my luck and tried sleeping in my dream. Curiosity kills the papushi. Asking! You'll alert the monsters! All the dead are right here. All of them!
You're not talking about the memory zone meme, are you?
Don't say that name! It's all your fault. They're coming!
There's more to life. Eternal.
In the mood for another beating?
Yes. It's time.
Stand down.
He passed out. His intense negative emotions attracted the nearby memory zone memes.
I see. But why aren't the other people around here scared?
Unlike in the sweet dream, people here don't see memory zone memes as dangerous monsters. And even if they pose a threat, people can easily escape by forcing a wake-up call. But we can't just leave this man here. Can we take him somewhere safe?
We can ask Jesse for help. I've gotten to know many locals while waiting for you guys. Everyone here is living a self-sufficient life. I don't know how to describe it, but this place feels like the real dreamscape. hold your liquor. Try to warn me.
See how you handle a stroke of genius like this.
Evening, Jesse. Is it evening?
Welcome, Miss March. Who might these be?
These two are my friends. As for the man lying on the ground, he's a scaredy cat who fainted from fright.
I see. Another poor guy who accidentally ended up here. I'll take care of him. There have been a lot of new faces lately. Things must be tough in the beautiful dream. The few remaining havens of freedom in Asdana will soon face trouble.
Do such things often happen here?
Not really, but they're becoming more frequent now. Guess it's one of the signs of the sweet dream's collapse. This man has had quite the shock. Could you help me find a Halovian lady, March? Her songs can heal mental wounds.
A Halovian lady?
That must be Robin. She's also here in Dreamflux Reef.
Huh? Robin? But I thought she... Oh, right. If Firefly is here safe and sound, then it means Robin must be okay too.
Misha is about to take us to her to find out what happened. But before that, let's meet up with Himiko. You were with her earlier, right?
We met some stowaways in the residential area. Most of them came from neighboring star systems. I heard that places like Dreamflux Reef are scattered throughout the memory zone of Asdana, like islands in the ocean. They existed before the family arrived. I also heard that when Dreamflux Reef took shape, it was the center of all dreamscapes in Penacony.
If that's true, it's no wonder there are so many similarities between this place and the Sweet Dream.
Himiko must be gathering information. Let's hurry up and get going!
Thank you.
Imagined we'd gather the remaining details here.
To borrow Gallagher's catchphrase, what an unpredictable twist of fate.
Himeko, here they are!
Ah, perfect timing. Now that everyone's here, I'd like to introduce everyone to Micah, who's partly in charge of the Land of the Exiles. Micah, these are my companions.
It's a pleasure to meet the Nameless.
You know us?
I've been keeping an eye on you since the day you arrived in Penacony. We would have met under more appropriate circumstances if Dreamflex Reef hadn't been isolated from the 12 Dreamscapes. Please, allow me to formally introduce myself. I'm Micah, the Gravekeeper of Dreamflex Reef.
Gravekeeper?
Life in Dreamflex Reef is pretty liberating. Everyone here mostly keeps to themselves, without meddling in others' affairs. My daily task involves cleaning a few tombstones.
You're too modest, Micah. When lost dream chasers stumble upon this place, you're the one who takes care of them, guiding them back to the sweet dream, or showing them how to survive the wild dream chaos.
So, a guardian of sorts.
Were you talking to me, Mr. Yang?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm?
On that note, Mr. Micah, which tombstones are you referring to? We didn't come across any graveyard when we arrived.
They're actually just symbolic stones. But since you're curious, Mr. Yang, I'll take you there. I have a feeling you might find something of interest there. But before that, you have an important guest joining you.
An important guest? Who could it be?
This way, please. The roads here in Dreamflex Reef are a bit run down, so watch your step.
It really is her! Miss Robin!
Everyone sang so wonderfully. It's not often that I tried this music style, but I've gained some valuable insights from it.
Oh, I can't thank you enough, Robin. Well, these kids have made incredible progress in only a few days.
It was nothing, Grace. I merely taught them how to sing. It was you who brought hope into their lives. Life must be quite difficult for them in reality, I imagine.
That's right.
Whenever it's time to say goodbye to these kids, they're reluctant to leave. But I've explored every corner of Dreamflux Reef, talked to everyone I met, and they all told me the same thing. This shattered dream is not worth clinging to.
It seems you truly are a child of the Harmony. Emma and Andy are orphans I took under my wing. Carol there, with her blind eyes, used to work at a nutrition center in the outer ring of Penacony. And as for Gary, he's been living with autism since he was a child. They're not old enough to enter the sweet dream managed by the family. If we compare people to birds, these kids are like fledglings with impaired wings. But in this dream, well, they can fly freely. Even if they stumble along the way, well, they're still relying on their own strength. And me, an old lady with no legs. Well, without this dream, I couldn't even walk toward them.
I'm glad that you found a new life here in Penacony. It's just...
Don't worry, Robin. Dreams have their significance, but they aren't everything. Both the children and I understand this. No matter how long we fly through this dream, we will one day return to reality. But you know what? Emma and Gary aren't plagued by their insecurities anymore. No, and Carol is learning how to cope with her blindness. And Andy is livelier than ever. Well, even I've become more optimistic. You see, in dreams, we learn how to live. Once we return to reality, we learn how to survive.
And should our feathers be damaged, then we share our wings with one another. There's no need to covet an illusory sky in dreams, because we have the right and the ability to fly towards a broader horizon.
It's a relief to see you safe and sound, Miss Robin.
It's nice to see you all again, Astral Express crew. I heard my disappearance cause quite the commotion out there. I'm really sorry about that.
Since you're here, can we assume that you're fully aware of the situation in Penacony?
Ever since I returned to Penacony, my voice started to change, until it gradually faded away. At first, I thought it was a temporary ailment, perhaps due to having been away too long. I thought maybe it just takes some time for my body to acclimate to the high concentration of Memoria and Asdana. But now it seems the root of the problem goes way beyond me. There are elements around me that don't align with the Harmony. Losing my voice is just one of the signs of the sweet dream's collapse.
The sweet dream's collapse? That memo keeper mentioned the same thing. So it's real.
While I was away from Penacony, the boundaries of the 12 dreamscapes kept expanding outward. But whenever I mentioned the anomalies in my dreams, all the family heads refused to talk about it. Only my brother was willing to respond. Later, I discovered the secret letters from the IPC ambassador, which further convinced me that there are hidden secrets beneath the surface of Penacony. So, following the clues in the Oak family's dossiers, I found my way here. The land of the exiles, concealed by the family under the guise of death. A dream within a dream. Penacony's past is buried.
Hearing you speak, it sounds as if your voice has made somewhat of a recovery.
I hate to admit it, but the Harmony in this place resonates more broadly than within the sweet dream. It's regrettable, but the family has experienced betrayal. The traitor, or traitors, abandoned their original principles and, using the name of Harmony, exploited people's weaknesses to turn Penacony into the planet of festivities, trapping everyone in the illusion of the sweet dream. This is not the strong defending the weak, but rather the strong exploiting the weak. A world without equality won't ever be favored by the harmony. And naturally, those voices blessed by them have lost the ability to sing.
Could there be another force influencing the family's shift in philosophy, Miss Robin? Considering what happened with Acheron, it's difficult to conceive of another entity within the realm of the harmony capable of influencing everyone. Unless a power surpassing that of an emanator is involved.
I'd heard about what happened to the Cienjo Alliance. But as far as I'm aware, the family hasn't faced any such external interventions. Who knows? Perhaps I've just been away too long and missed something. Regardless, I cannot accept my home is moving towards the very opposite of what the harmony represents, while still claiming to uphold it. I must uncover the reason why Mikhail cut ties with the family, and who exactly it was who betrayed us all. Do you remember our arrangement, Mr. Micah? Well, here's my answer. I've decided to forgo my role, and never step foot on the Charmony Festival stage again.
Look here, brother. A little bird.
Looks like a fledgling Charmony dove. But Charmony doves don't live here. So how did this little bird get here? Maybe its parents abandoned it?
It looks weak and frail. Why don't we find something soft and make a nest for it?
This place is too dangerous for a fledgling. Let's take it with us. We can put it on the wooden shelf in front of your window.
Okay. A bird like that must have a beautiful singing voice. But where will it live?
I'll ask the family head to build a cage for it.
A cage? Then it won't have the freedom to fly, right?
Let's see. What is it that has captured the attention of the two best interpreters of the Great One? To the point that they've forgotten how to enjoy their dessert. Oh, poor little thing. Doesn't look like it's doing well. Do you want to rescue it?
I do. But I don't want to lock it up in a cage.
Why?
Even if it's small and not fully feathered, and can't sing, it didn't come into this world just to be locked up in a cage. Birds, they should be flying free in the sky.
That's quite the romantic idea. And what about you, our young scholar? Do you agree with your sister?
I think she's right. But if we leave it out in the wild, it won't survive for more than a few days at best.
Ah, I see. It seems our little scholar is still a bit unsure. Well, let me tell you youngsters a story. As you probably know, Charmony doves can fly through the air. When they fly really high, the friction caused by the flapping of their feathers against the atmosphere creates amazing lights so that they look like shooting stars. We've seen this spectacle so many times that we think it's just something they can naturally do. But that's not the truth. Their radiant display is the result of countless struggles against nature over generations. Their ancestors were too weak to survive on the ground. So, to escape predators, they started seeking new opportunities in the air. After countless attempts by many generations, one of them finally figured out how to fly. It soared into the sky and never looked back at the ground again.
So, you mean birds aren't born to fly, but they find a way to do it through their determination, right?
Well, that's an idealistic way of putting it. So, what are your thoughts, Sunday?
I think people believe birds are meant to fly because they've never seen those birds crashing to their death.
That's an interesting perspective. So, have you decided what to do with the bird now?
For now, I'll keep it in a cage until it can take care of itself because I want it to live, no matter what.
Well said, kids. It seems each of you has found your own answer. Your insights are truly remarkable, and I hope they come true in their own way.
We will take good care of it, won't we, brother?
Yeah. But, Mr. Gopherwood, there's one thing I don't quite understand.
And what might that be, my son?
What if this little Charmony dove never learns to fly in the end? I mean, if there are fledglings in this world that can never fly throughout their lives, should we let them go back to the sky, only to see them crash to the ground and die?
Talking in your sleep, Birdie? Time to wake up. Huh? Need a hand?
I'm still alive?
Yeah. Happy about that.
Where is Robin? Tell me. Now.
I knew that was going to be the first thing you'd ask. Don't worry, your sister is here, safe and sound. She's probably walking around the streets now. If I were you, I'd be more worried about myself. After all, right in front of you is the guy who just stabbed you in the chest with a dagger.
If you wanted to kill me, you wouldn't give me the chance to speak. Just tell me your demands, lackey of the Watchmaker.
So, you figured out who I am, huh? No wonder you had the guts to go against the Dream Master and the four families. Looks like I made the right choice.
Choice?
You are aware of my plan and see through my act. Time is running out. So let's drop the charades. I'm suggesting we cooperate.
Cooperate? What makes you think I'd cooperate with you?
The fact that the famous Robin has chosen my side. Plus, some clues about a traitor and a bright future for Penacony. Any of that catch your interest?
I find it hard to believe a man who's full of deception.
Fine. You don't have to trust me. What you should trust is the sense of justice inside of you.
Show me Robin first.
All right, as you wish. Here she is.
Huh?
What's your trick this time?
Just kidding. I mean, this lady will lead us to Robin, right?
And the crew, too. There are too many people who you owe an explanation.
That'd be great. Please follow me, Honorable Oak Family Head. Now, all the actors are on the stage.
This is the monument I mentioned earlier. The names inscribed on it should be familiar to all of you.
Rosalina and Tiernan.
When Penacony was known as a frontier prison, it was the trailblazers who connected it with the stars. They were the heroes who saved Astana, and their names deserve to be immortalized. Not just on the small stone tablet, but in the annals of history for all of time. However, today, the planet of festivities is nothing but sweet dreams. That heavy piece of history is all a distant memory. Just like that prison.
If their names are inscribed here, then that means...
According to Micah, they died long ago.
Rosalina was killed during the War of Independence. She ventured alone into the heart of the star system to investigate the flow of Memoria, but she never returned. Tiernan was a skilled gunslinger, strong and reliable. He led the people through countless battles, but he didn't live long enough to witness the arrival of true peace. In the decade following the war, Penacony faced challenges internal and external. To protect Astana, Tiernan took up the way of the Trailblaze and led the Lampmoth family to explore beyond the system, only to be surrounded and wiped out by the Swarm.
Though I had expected as much, the tales of these heroes truly are sorrowful.
True to the title of Trailblazer, they spent their lives venturing into the unknown. But what about this tablet? There are no names carved on it.
When Dreamflux Reef was created, its owner was still alive. However, he insisted on erecting a monument for himself, saying that it will happen someday. Here we meet again. Everyone from the Astral Express.
Robin.
Nice.
I promised to give the siblings some privacy, so let's talk about our business first. What do you say?
That sounds sensible enough. Since you went through the trouble of gathering the family head, the crew, and the Stellaron hunters, I'm guessing you have something important to say, Mr. Gallagher?
Oh? Is it that obvious?
The look on your face is practically screaming, I'm the one behind all this.
You're right, Mr. Yang. It is indeed time to come clean on everything. The siblings already know what they need to, and they've made their choice. But you, Nameless, arrived a bit late. So it's only fair that I answer your questions. Before we begin, let me reintroduce myself. I'm the founder of Dream Flux Reef, the deputy of the Watchmaker, and the one who sent out that invitation. As Gallagher, the history fictionologist, I humbly extend my greetings to you all.
History fictionologist? So what? Everything you told us was made up?
Well, don't worry. Almost everything I shared was true. Well, except for the part about the family accepting me back.
I double-checked with Micah, and everything he said about the family, the Watchmaker, and Mikhail is true.
Thank you for your understanding. Now let's get down to business. I'm sure you're all wondering why I went through the trouble of setting up this battle for the legacy, inviting different factions, stirring up a ruckus all over Penacony. Well, it all boils down to something very familiar to all of you. The Stellaron.
The Stellaron? But how is that possible? Penacony is a free-flowing interstellar hub. There are no signs of contamination whatsoever.
You're totally correct. So, care to take a guess at what that means? How keen. Well, what should I say? I expected nothing less from the person here who is the most familiar with Stellarons. The Sweet Dream doesn't come out of thin air. If you think of the Memory Zone as the sea, creating the land of the dreams is like filling that wild ocean with earth to make an island. To achieve this feat, without the help of an Emanator of Remembrance or Enigmata, the only way is to use a Stellaron. And that's not something you can achieve with a simple wish. It requires vast quantities of knowledge, time, and manpower. I'm sure you get what I'm hinting at. In Asdana, the planet of festivities itself is a Stellaron disaster.
The planet of festivities itself is a Stellaron disaster?
It all started a long time ago, back when the Watchmaker and his crew liberated the Frontier Prison. They faced countless challenges as they began building Penacony from the ground up. That's when the idea of using the Stellaron came into play. The Stellaron first entered the Asdana system during the war. The Nameless warned everyone against the folly of attempting to tamper with such a power, and most heeded their words. But there are always people in the shadows with ulterior motives. The turning point came after Tiernan's death. With two of the Nameless gone, the Watchmaker had to go to the front lines. It was at that moment his rivals saw an opportunity. By the time a representative from the Montour system's family arrived at the Watchmaker's call, the Stellaron had already been activated and was seeping into the primordial synesthesia dreamscape.
And I suppose the family happened to possess the knowledge to seal the Stellaron?
Not just that. They knew far more about the Stellaron than the average person. They helped Mikhail swiftly quell the civil unrest and played a part in building Penacony under the disguise of the Harmony. Those three eras were known as the Age of Dreaming. The Watchmaker, who had been left in the dark, sent out invitations across the universe, spreading the hype around the land of the dreams.
then, how did they turn against each other?
Remember the island in the ocean metaphor? The truth is, the Stellaron was never truly sealed. It existed in a different form within the dreamscape. Think about this. What would it cost to create and maintain such a lavish dreamland? It's people's lives. The opulent dream is built upon the decay of spirits, with a toxic elixir called pleasure flowing through the dreamscape. It tempts people to indulge in the dreamscape, and gradually their minds succumb, becoming nourishment for the sweet dream. Confusion, laziness, and cowardice, weaknesses that plague humanity, were magnified and nourished by the family. Panicone became a new kind of prison, even more impenetrable than the previous one. Sadly, we realized this far too late. By then, the family had a firm grip on Panicone, swiftly quelling any opposition that arose. At my wit's end, I had to use the power of the Enigmata and sought refuge in this chaotic realm. Over the years, I created a meme within this dream for our use. Dormancy. That's its real name. We exploited a loophole. You see, regular people can't fall asleep again while they are inside the dreamscape.
So this is the true meaning of the impossible. You sent out invitations in the Watchmaker's name to find forces capable of resolving the Stellaron disaster and draw them into Panicone to uncover the truth.
It's not just that. Above all, I wanted to see what happens when the major factions engage in a struggle for the legacy. Since this is the Watchmaker's first announcement in decades, the traitor within the family is bound to reveal themselves.
So, the legacy is just a facade.
If you want to consider the Stellaron as the legacy, I'm totally fine with that.
If that's the case, where is the Stellaron now?
That's a question for Mr. Wings. The Stellaron is still under the family's control, and as the head of the Oak family, I'm sure he holds all the answers.
As I suspected, the core of this issue lies within the Stellaron.
You all look quite serious. Is there anything I can do to help?
Are you done talking? So, will you tell us where the Stellaron is?
It is the Panicone Grand Theater itself.
As I suspected, it's the embodiment of the family. The edifice that first materialized within the sweet dream. That's what turned Panicone into its current state.
As for the person who employed its power, it is in fact Mr. Gopherwood, the current Dream Master.
Well, that was easier than I thought. Did you conduct your own investigation already?
Correct. When I was trying to track down the person who murdered my sister, apart from you, Gopherwood was my second suspect.
Confronting me first turned out to be a smart move on your part.
I didn't have other options. The Dream Master has been elusive, and even the heads of the families can hardly get an audience with him. Moreover, Mr. Gopherwood has been kind to my sister and me, and I didn't want it all to end like this.
What do you mean by that?
To be honest, my brother and I are also victims of the cancer of all worlds. We grew up as orphans, and were adopted by the family when they came to help. Mr. Gopherwood recognized our potential and brought us to Panicone. But I can't just stand by and watch Mr. Gopherwood become an enemy of the Harmony. I won't use my voice to support an evil cause. I won't step on that stage and sing, no matter who the traitor is or what orders they give me. I won't let the Charmony Festival become an event that destroys harmony itself, or the paradise in our dreams.
Indeed, for the paradise in our dreams. As the head of the Oak family, I'm responsible for ensuring Panicone's promising future. Robin and I will head into the Sweet Dream and confront the Dream Master. And if it turns out that the family has truly strayed from the harmony, I'll fight alongside you. We'll put the Charmony Festival on hold and make sure Mr. Gopherwood pays for his blood debt.
The enemies you are about to face aren't like this old dog here, who can barely even bark. Since our interests are aligned, why don't we team up? Maybe, just maybe, we'll have a shot at success.
We have always been following in the footsteps of our nameless predecessors, and there's no reason to stop now.
Yeah, we nameless won't back down from a challenge. Isn't that right, Mr. Trailblazer? Exactly! It's time for the crew to save the world once more!
Rest assured, sitting on the sidelines isn't in our nature. Mr. Sunday, Miss Robin, I'm willing to accompany you on behalf of the Astral Express. Having a third party present should help with negotiations, and could make all the difference if things get ugly.
Thank you, Mr. Yang.
Thank you all very much.
The Charmony Festival is about to start, and time is against us. We must hasten.
Everyone, let's gather over here. We still need to make some preparations. I may have been quick to step up to the plate, but confronting the Dream Master could be a very dangerous affair.
Uh-huh. Even you're saying that, Mr. Yang? How powerful is that Dream Master?
He's the leader of the families of Panicone, and he has the entire power of the Harmony behind him. Not to mention the Stellaron in his possession. We must proceed with great caution.
Maybe you can just stay behind this time, Mr. Yang?
No, that won't do. Even if we count Robin as an ally, something felt off about Mr. Sunday just now. Although, I can't quite put my finger on it. I have to make sure he won't turn against us when things start to get dicey. You're still carrying the keepsake the IPC envoy gave you, right? May I borrow it for a moment? As I suspected, this chip Venturine gave to you is actually a miniature transmitter. If I'm right, he intends to use it to track your location or contact you when needed. As it so happens, this may actually be of some use in the current situation.
Venturine? Is he still alive? And what does he have to do with our mission to confront the Dream Master?
Remember what I said earlier? Working with the IPC is a way to keep the family in check. If negotiations go south and the family show their true colors by going after the Stellaron, I'll use this transmitter to send a message to the IPC. It'll be just the opportunity the IPC ambassador was hoping for. The only question mark in all of this is Venturine's current status. But the IPC is always listening, especially senior strategic investment department heads like him. Getting the message across shouldn't be a problem.
Good luck to you, Welt.
Well, you take care too. If anything goes wrong, don't worry about me. Just make sure to seal the Stellaron.
Spoken like a true hero. Even if the Dream Master is innocent, The family's corruption runs deep. I won't make the same mistake Mikhail did. Let's wish him the best of luck.
Don't you have something else to tell us, Gallagher?
Why would you say so?
Before we departed, the conductor asked us to inquire about the three nameless in Penacony. We've already collected intel about Rosalina and Tiernan, so the only one left is Lightwork. If I'm not mistaken, we've already met him somewhere, haven't we?
It's not enough to say meet, but the answer is pretty obvious. After all, I've hinted at it in quite an evident way. I've been watching over you ever since I received the reply from the Astral Express, and I've seen the great effort you all put into linking different realms together across the cosmos. And now, after getting this far all in one piece, you have truly proven yourselves. Miss Himiko, were you the one who repaired the Express and got it sailing through the cosmos again?
Yes.
And you two, young Nameless, you have very interesting life stories and extraordinary skills.
What? Hey, you can't just make up titles like that.
You're full of energy. Please send my regards to the conductor, Pom Pom. Please let them know that their friend had fond memories from his time aboard the Express, which he reminisced on every time he had a good drink. As for the last Nameless, he embarked, disembarked, and embarked again, traveling in a great circle, ending up back where he started. On his deathbed, he told me to find the Astral Express and deliver an invitation to the future Nameless. He left behind a special gift, a true legacy. Something that belongs only to the successors of the Trailblaze. Come with me. Now is the time to reveal it.
Back here again.
Sometimes I feel like you're still alive, old friend. Like you've still got so much to say and do. I've kept my promise, brought the future Trailblazers you've waited so long for. I don't know why you were so obsessed with that train, but I remember your last words. Don't let us down, old man. His resting place lies in the garden up ahead. The first and last Nameless of Penacony. Mikhail Char Legward, the Watchmaker. Thank you.
sure enough. The Watchmaker is the third Nameless. Even I could guess that one.
The legacy he left behind was a dream bubble. I believe inside that bubble, there's something that holds meaning only for the Nameless. After all, when I checked its contents, I found nothing inside. Maybe some Trailblaze runes? Even more mysterious than me.
Well, let's have a look.
Just as I suspected. That old man always had this strange belief in the Nameless and the Trailblaze. And I never understood where he got that confidence from. Especially since he never managed to get in touch with the Express while he was alive. I could never figure out what was going on in that old man's head. But this empty dream bubble is so typical of him. He was always full of weird fantasies and incomprehensible romanticism. That mischievous old man. Well, I didn't expect him to leave anything concrete behind anyway.
Don't think that's the case, Gallagher. I'm sure Mikhail has left us the most precious thing of all.
Don't start getting all philosophical on me, all right?
Just as Mikhail believes in the Nameless of the future, we unconditionally believe in the Nameless of the past. How could they leave with regrets for the future when they were ready to dedicate their lives to the land they loved? There must be something contained in this dream bubble. It's just we haven't figured it out yet. You also have faith in the Watchmaker, don't you, Gallagher?
Well, I'm a follower of the Enigmata. My philosophy forbids me to have faith in anything. That's why I understand what faith means in the path of Trailblaze. And I also want to know what he left behind. I'll leave it to you guys then.
Can I borrow your pet? I need to make a trip back to Golden Hour and check something at the Dreamscape sales store. It's for Mikhail, and for the future of Penacony.
Welcome to the Reverie Hotel. How may I help you?
Greetings. We're the Nameless from the Astral Express, and we'd like to check in.
The Astral Express? But I thought...
Yes, my companions already checked in. My name is Dan Hung, and I believe my personal information is recorded in your system.
I see, but your companion said you wouldn't be coming due to a change of plans.
Now the plans have changed again.
And you are...
Me? I'm Pong Pong. A new Nameless, who's also with the Astral Express.
He's my fellow trailblazer. We responded to the family's invitation before he boarded the express. So he wasn't registered in your system. Is it possible to accommodate him as well?
Oh, I see. Another one of the Nameless had a similar situation. Seems like a lot of people are joining the Trailblaze these days. Since there's a precedent, it shouldn't be a problem. Just give me a second to contact your companions. I'm sorry, dear guests, but it seems I'm unable to reach the other members of the Astral Express.
What do you mean by unable to reach them?
My apologies. This is the first time I've encountered a situation like this. However, the system indicates that those guests are still in the dreamscape.
How about this? Give me their room number. We'll go check on them ourselves.
I'm afraid that's not possible. I need to verify both of your identities before I can share any guest information.
How about you just wake up someone? Let's say, Wilt.
I'm sorry, but there are strict rules regarding forced awakening. It cannot be done without the proper clearance.
So nothing works, huh? What's your solution, then? Are you saying we sleep here? At the reception?
Please be patient. We need to contact your companions in order to confirm your identities.
And now it seems you need to confirm our identities before you can contact our companions.
It seems so.
Oh, fudge! Look, nothing personal, but if you can't handle this, go find someone else who can, okay?
Please calm down, dear guests. I do recall that Mr. Sunday, the Oak family head, personally handled this issue earlier. Oh, please wait a moment while I contact him.
I don't think she's trying to give us a hard time. She really just doesn't know what to do.
I have a bad feeling about this. You tried to contact them on the express earlier, but they didn't respond.
Something doesn't seem right. I need to leave for a moment. You can stay here with the receptionist.
Sure thing. Just don't keep me waiting forever. Bellhome seems pretty worried about his companions. I should give him some space. Stressing out about it won't help anything. Here for the Charmany Festival, too.
Well, I didn't come all the way here specially for the festival. Honestly, I don't really even know what it's about, but I heard it's a lot of fun!
Well, back in my homeworld, Anaria, we have festivals like that all the time. My dad threw me a birthday party one time that was just as extravagant as the Charmany Festival.
Come on! The Charmany Festival is a once-in-an-amber-era event! How can a birthday party compare?
Well, you never know, right? Maybe on her world, birthdays only happen once in amber-era. Anyway, let's forget about that. Have you heard about the, unsettling things happening in the dreamscape?
Unsettling things? What could possibly go wrong? It better not ruin the Charmany Festival! I've been looking forward to it!
Relax. With a big event like this, there's bound to be lots of gossip and rumors. Don't worry. If anything does happen, the family will be on top of it.
Oh, that's a relief. I didn't come all this way to see the festival go down the drain. Well, looks like I won't get any fudging clues out of these two. They're clueless. recognition failed.
Greetings. I'm Cody of the Bloodhound family, head of security for the hotel. How may I assist you?
Hello. So, there's something I wanted to ask about. I've been hearing some unsettling rumors about certain incidents that might affect the Charmony Festival. Do you think there's anything to be worried about? I've traveled all the way from the Hayai Federation, and I don't want my trip to be ruined.
What do you mean?
Wait. You haven't heard.
I'm not sure where you heard those rumors, but they're completely baseless. I can assure you, as a representative of the Bloodhound family, that everything is going smoothly for the Charmony Festival. At present, all of the families are focused on making sure the festival starts on time. Even the Dream Master himself has arrived. So don't worry, your trip won't be in vain.
Ah, that's a relief to hear. She doesn't appear to be acting. So, it seems that even the hotel staff are out of the loop. Back already?
Hasn't she returned yet?
Nope. I'm starting to wonder if sending her to contact Sunday was a good idea. Neither the staff nor the guests seem to know anything about what's happening in the dreamscape, and wherever we go, all we see is people enjoying themselves. Definitely not a good sign.
I agree. Another unusual thing is that the Oak family is supposed to be in charge of organizing the council and managing everything inside and outside the dreamscape. However, I walked around the hotel, but didn't meet a single member of the Oak family on such an important day.
Well, I'll be forked. If I remember correctly, the head of the Oak family is that Sunday guy, right?
We shouldn't linger here too long. Let's go back to the Express for now.
Not so fast. Have you ever robbed the IPC, bro? If you run away now, everyone will be chasing after you.
Are you suggesting we sit here and do nothing?
I wouldn't say do nothing. But let's stay put for now. Even if the family has ulterior motives, they couldn't have anticipated us showing up here. We're the surprise factor for them. They don't want to attract unwanted attention from certain outsiders, so they won't do anything reckless. See? The IPC lackeys are keeping a close eye on this hotel.
If I were a family member, I'd find an official excuse and keep the surprise factors here. If we just wait here, that would be like walking into their trap.
Of course, we don't need to walk into their trap. I gave a backup plan to the memo keeper. If it turns out we won't be allowed to enter the dreamscape, she'll order a drink for me in the VIP lounge at the hotel. In reality,
a secret signal.
That's right.
Oh, a concrete object can indeed help the memo keeper establish a connection with you. But Boothill, if you have more backup plans in the future, I hope you'll let me know in advance.
I'm sorry, but it's one of my quirks. I have too many unreliable friends. And if I reveal that I have backup plans, things can go awry. And that would leave all backup plans completely useless.
How do we get into the VIP lounge?
This is where my street smarts come into play.
Ooh, this dream's quite crowded.
You're the lobby manager, right?
Yes, I am. How may I
assist you?
We're the Nameless from the Astral Express. We wanted to check in, but there's something wrong with your system. The lady at the front desk said she would contact the manager, but now she's nowhere to be found. Now, we've been waiting here forever, without any food or water. What the fork, man? Is this how the family treats its guests?
Is this your idea of street smarts? Starting an altercation?
It's called standing up for your rights.
I apologize for the inconvenience. Please wait while we try to contact Mr. Sunday. I'll arrange 2 premium seats in the VIP lounge so you can rest there while you wait.
See? Just like that.
Just don't call yourself Nameless next time.
Wow, this bar's something else. Certainly worthy of the Planet of Festivities.
One peach soul, Glad. Shaken, not.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Hey, I have an order for a bottle of Hasdana's White Oak. Can you help us find it?
Hasdana's White Oak? I think there might be a misunderstanding. We don't serve that here.
Oh, no way. Are you sure you're not mistaken?
If someone had reserved such a beverage, I would definitely remember it. It sells for hundreds of thousands of credits per bottle, after all. I couldn't afford to cover for such an item if it were broken or lost.
That's strange. Well, could it be that the memo keeper couldn't afford it?
Then what should we do now?
Oh, no need to rush. Let's grab some drinks first. Maybe I arrived too early and he hasn't come yet. Now, let's see what kind of juice malts you all have here. Give me a glass of Heenum Valley, 40 years. I'll have it neat. No ice.
Well, that's the most expensive one on the list. You have a taste for the finer things.
It's on the house, anyway.
What can I get for you?
Anything you recommend is fine.
Then I would recommend today's special, Glass Village. It's classic Soul Glad mixed with Laboom juice. It's refreshing and suits your cool demeanor. Just one minute.
This flavor. Dynamite barbecue with rocket fuel. Ooh, it really hits the spot. Truly the finest sherry cask aged malt juice in the cosmos.
Dynamite barbecue with rocket fuel, Earth. Is that really something that humans enjoy?
Hey, this guy doesn't know anything at all.
As long as you're satisfied, dear guests, please enjoy.
Let's give the memo keeper another half system hour. If she doesn't show up, we'll need to come up with a new plan. In the meantime, let's take stock of the situation. What do you think?
The situation is unclear. Something must have happened on the Planet of Festivities, but the public is unaware of it. Someone in a position of power within the family must be covering it up. It's unusual for the followers of the Harmony to invite other factions, let alone the IPC and the Masked Fools. If what you said about the Emanator of the Nihility is true, the situation in Penacony is a little complicated, to say the least.
Actually, there's something else I'm concerned about. Regarding Acheron. As you know, the faction that follows the path of the Hunt are some of the most dangerous folks in the cosmos to mess with. I mean, who in the right mind would impersonate the Xianzhou Alliance or the Galaxy Rangers. It's like asking for a death wish. Isn't there a saying among the Xianzhou people that the Rainbow Sect lets their Lux Aero do all the beating?
Talking. Do all the talking.
Well, you know what I mean. Even though the Galaxy Rangers have been out of sight for years, we've been keeping an eye on this region. Even the dumbest criminals know better than to mess with the Annihilation Gang, much less the Rangers. But that Acheron lady, she doesn't seem like a lunatic at all. On the contrary, she's highly logical and organized. She knows exactly when to hold back and when to strike without mercy.
And you believe that someone like her would have an ulterior motive for impersonating a Galaxy Ranger?
I'm not entirely sure, but I do have my suspicions. Maybe she knows a Galaxy Ranger, or perhaps she's trying to lure us out for some reason, which I can't figure out.
Anyway, what worries me more are the anomalies within the family. They've summoned followers from various paths for the festival. No matter how generous such a gesture is, this move seems highly unusual. Unless the invitations weren't sent by them. If that's the case, it's even more intriguing that the family insists on organizing the Charmony Festival, despite the chaos.
Maybe it's Shi Pei the Harmony pulling the strings. You find it beyond human understanding because it wasn't arranged by humans at all. People do stupid things out of irrational impulses. They abandon their principles when self-interest is involved. They believe in things they know they shouldn't, and fudge, they even break their own rules. But eons don't. They stick to their determined path and never turn back, even if they reach a dead end.
You think Shi Pei's will is behind all this?
It may not necessarily be Shi Pei, but there's definitely some higher entity involved. I know it may sound pessimistic, but if human free will were reliable, why would we even need Galaxy Rangers? It's much simpler when you boil it down to the eons and paths. Like how Lon always follows the path of the hunt, or how the Express stays true to the Trailblaze despite Akavili's disappearance.
But in my opinion, Akavili's fall holds significance for the Nameless.
Oh. So you're saying the Nameless now have to take responsibility for their own choices because their absolutely right leader is gone?
Exactly. I believe the purpose of the journey isn't just about following a path that's always considered absolutely right. It's more about doing your best to choose the right path for yourself among countless possibilities, even with limited insight and judgment.
I don't know what you've been through, but I agree that people must take responsibility for their choices, because no one else can do it for them. That's why the Galaxy Rangers need to uncover the imposter and figure out her true intentions. Just in case. I have a backup plan if the Memo Keeper doesn't show up. This is my final backup plan. I promise.
You sure have a lot of cards up your sleeve.
Well, going back to my old career would make things a lot easier. And by the way, when you were walking around the hotel, did you happen to see any important-looking guests?
What's your plan?
It's simple. We just grab some hostages and use them as bargaining chips with the family. Or maybe we can even take their identities.
No need for that. We'll return to the Express now.
Wait. Are you getting scared? Draw your weapon. Let's make a big scene.
Are you leaving, esteemed guests? Would you like to cancel that Asdana's White Oak you just ordered?
Huh? Asdana's White Oak? But didn't you just say...
Ha ha. Looks like you are a bit intoxicated, esteemed guests. You ordered a bottle of Asdana's White Oak just a moment ago.
Looks like your memo keeper friend has finally arrived.
Oh, right. Sorry, my memory's not the best. You know, too many modifications and all. Anyway, let me check. Well, fork me. It's Asdana's White Oak, all right. And there's a note. I'll be waiting for you on the Astral Express.
No mistake, that's her message to you. She knew the hotel wasn't safe, so she suggested we find another place.
Well, looks like we took a detour, but now it's back to the Astral Express. So, what are we waiting for? Let's go.
Guests just boarded saying they were looking for Boot Hill, so I told them to wait in the parlor car.
Oh, just in time.
Two guests?
Yeah, or two. Look, we welcome all passengers on the Astral Express, but sneaking in like that, you have no regard for etiquette.
My apologies, conductor. It was an oversight on my part. I assumed you were already acquainted with the garden. Given the chaotic situation in Penacony, the Nameless are the only ones we can truly trust right now.
You are the memo keeper.
Pleased to meet you, Dan Hung. I've seen you in others' memories. And as for Boot Hill, this is our first face-to-face meeting. I hope you enjoyed that bottle of Asdana's White Oak. You sure have a refined taste.
Finally, Memo Keeper. Well, let's cut to the chase. Spill everything you know.
That's precisely what I intend to do. But before that, please allow me to introduce myself. My name is Black Swan. And I serve the Garden of Recollection as a memo keeper. As for Acheron's story, I'm sure she knows it better than I do.
Greetings. I'm Acheron.
What? You Garden of Recollection shirtbag! You betrayed me!
I apologize, but she did that at my request. Due to certain reasons, I have been exiled by the family. Thankfully, this memo keeper came to my aid and helped me escape their surveillance unnoticed.
To be honest, it was more like stalking than helping. And the process was far from unnoticed. But we did escape.
I asked her to guide me to a place beyond the family's reach and to contact a few trustworthy individuals, namely, all of you.
Trustworthy? Son of a nice lady, you think I'm dumb or something? How about this? I'll put a few bullet holes in your head and see what secrets spill out. Then, we can talk about trust.
It doesn't have to be like that. I'm willing to answer all your questions, but not right now. If my cover hadn't been blown, we might have had more time, but at the moment, we don't have any other options.
No other options? What do you mean?
This is the only way I can ensure everyone's safety. I kindly request an immediate warp jump out of the Astana star system.
Is requesting?
As far as I can tell, She's not a threat, and seems to be telling the truth.
I've briefly traveled with your companions and know their whereabouts, Donhung. Please rest assured, your nameless companions are safe, but they need our help. As for Boot Hill, you may have guessed. I've been waiting for you. Galaxy Rangers are known for their elusive nature and limited contact with each other. So this was the only way I could reach out to you. Only by doing this can I find a true Galaxy Ranger and fulfill a long-standing promise. To return his relics to their rightful owner. Someone once told me that every rainfall is like a gift from the heavens, a sign of their mercy upon the world. Raindrops are said to be the tears of the gods, shed in response to the sorrows of the world. Their constant pouring is a reminder that the gods haven't abandoned us yet. So, how long has this rain been going on for?
I used to believe, just like you, that it would eventually stop. Years and decades passed. And in the end, such hope faded away before the rain did. Looks like the god you mentioned doesn't exist after all. Well, let me share a story with you. Mortals who walk the paths are like sailors on a vast ocean, leaving behind a trail that creates countless ripples of possibilities. These ripples last longer than the fleeting lifetimes of humans. And for some, their presence leaves such a strong mark that it's reflected in the waves.
Like those shadows on the ocean.
Sin thirsters, the obsessions of the Path Striders, they emerge from the depths of IX, seeing themselves as masters of their own destiny, unknowingly repeating the actions of their past lives. They emerge from the nihility and head toward it, leading purposeless lives. However, these hollow phantoms, they were once my dear companions. A group of Galaxy Rangers.
Are you watching over them?
Watching over them? No. I'm guiding them toward transcendence. It was a brutal war. A crusade that shook the universe. The universe witnessed the fall of Zulo, the Lord Ravager, but it came at a price. A price so hefty that only those who were there still remember. The unwavering determination of the hunt followers persists even in death. So someone must guide these lost souls to their life beyond. They were heroes in their time, and they shouldn't be reduced to mere puppets of nihility. As for me, I've suffered too many losses on that battlefield to advance any further. And that makes me the most fitting person to carry out this task.
But you know, these sin-thirsters, they're not who they used to be.
Does this seem pointless to you? Well, some tasks have to be done, even if they are pointless.
I can help you.
For what?
For the meaning of the Nihility. That's what I've been seeking.
I see. After all, this realm is off limits to ordinary souls, right? Thank you, stranger. I wish that you find what you seek.
Before we part ways, I have one more question. It is true that their actions and even their entire lives may seem pointless from our perspective. But if, and it's just an if this is what the departed ones expected, should we try to change it?
A good question, and a profound one. I don't know the answer. What I do know is that one day, I too will pass away. And when I bid farewell to this world, someone will stand at my grave and place a bouquet of flowers on it.
When I appeared as a child, my speech, mindset, and soul reflected immaturity and innocence. As I grew into adulthood, I left behind my childlike side.
I humbly request your blessings, esteemed advocate of Shipe.
Come to me, my kinship. I have sought their presence with us.
As you wish. I have faithfully served the Alfalfa family for nearly a decade, promoting the path of the Harmony to the best of my ability. However, I made a mistake yesterday. While I was preparing dinner for the family head, I accidentally dropped a prepared dish on the floor. Out of laziness, I lied and claimed that everything was ready. Although the head has dismissed me as punishment, it has been tough to sleep with the guilt still gnawing at me, as I worry that the seeds of evilness may have taken root in my soul. So, I confess to you now to seek atonement for my sins.
Do you sincerely repent and vow to change your ways?
Yes.
Have you examined your soul and confessed all your sins?
Oh, yes.
Are you willing to accept the process of atonement?
Yes.
Very well. Show your dedication and goodwill to the family, and you shall be reinstated among them. Now, please, leave in peace.
Oh, praise Shipe. And thank you, esteemed advocate.
Next, please step forward.
I wholeheartedly confess to you. Please pardon my sins.
Rest assured, I have implored their presence to be with us. As long as you are sincere, absolution will be granted.
Oh, oh great. You know, I arrived in Panaconi as a stowaway. I sold everything to get a ticket. My house, my land, and my two children.
I see. Please, go on.
My children were starving, and I hoped they'd have a chance at survival if they became slaves here. If I can strike it rich here, I'll lift them out of that situation and give them the life they deserve. But the Bloodhound family got wind of it. They're on my tail, hunting me down. I thought I could bring my kids here. It was all my fault. All my fault.
The family is ready to forgive all sinners. I'll ask the Bloodhound family to cease their pursuit. You don't need to live in fear anymore.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'll work my hardest to redeem my children and make them part of the family. Praise the harmony!
Next, please step forward.
Hey! Long time no see, Mr. Sunday. The most esteemed individual in Panaconi, and the next leader of the Oak family, right?
I have sought their presence with us. Let us proceed.
Sure. Let's just get this over with. I have sinned. Please forgive me. I wasted half a pizza at breakfast and a bottle of Soul Glad. That's it. Nothing more. When we wrap this up, I've got a robo-ball game to catch, you know?
Do you seek to atone for your sins through good deeds?
My sins? Wow, starting to sound like a saint, huh? Well, let me tell you something. Neither the family nor you have the right to judge me. You think nobody knows what your precious family has done? About the Watchmaker? Huh? Don't kid yourself, Featherbrain. Those dream chasers might be fooled by your act, but don't fool yourself. Before you start spouting off your holy verses, answer me this. Where does the power of the Oak family come from? And your power? What makes you think you can sit there all high and mighty, looking down on everyone else? Well, I've spent enough time in confession today to enter the Harmony's paradise, right? Then I'll take my leave. Good luck with your election, and, don't make me regret my investments in you.
Oh, revered triple-faced soul, hear my doubts. Who can judge the strong when their power hides their crimes? Who can vouch for the weak when they will pay any price to survive? Who can comfort the purest souls when even they get led astray? If the strong defending the weak is truly the foundation of paradise, then who is responsible for the suffering and anguish in this wretched world?
Brother? Brother? Brother, are you all right?
I'm fine. I've been working long hours, and I just made a trip to Dreamflux Reef and back. So, I'm a bit out of sorts. But it'll all be over before we know it.
You've been working nonstop on the Charmany Festival, Mr. Sunday, and no one could have predicted this incident. Even if the Stellaron does pose a grave threat, I still feel sorry for all the trouble we've caused you.
No need to worry about troubling anyone. The Charmany Festival was meant to spread joy and harmony across the cosmos. But now that we know the truth, I'm afraid we'll have to cancel it.
It has always been our wish to make everyone happy, so we'll do our best to explain everything to the Dream Master. I'm sure he'll understand. Even if the negotiation does not go smoothly, I'll refuse to go on stage. Without the Chordmaster, the Harmonious Choir would not arrive, and the Charmany Festival would be just a grand performance, and nothing more.
I'm relieved to see your determination. You know, since arriving in Penacony, we haven't had any contact with this Dream Master himself. I'd heard of the heads of the five major lineages, but the Dream Master is a mystery to me.
The Dream Master rarely grants an audience, even for us. But given the urgency of the situation, he's agreed to meet us in person.
Perhaps he'll be the first guest to meet the Dream Master in years, Mr. Yang.
Let's hope we can reach a consensus that satisfies everyone.
Indeed. Let us hope so.
It's about time. We'll have to get ready for the meeting. I apologize for any inconvenience caused by the urgency.
Don't worry. I'll be waiting here.
It's Mr. Sunday! Hey! Come over here!
Looks like someone needs help. Let's go check it out.
Oh, Mr. Sunday. Hey there! Okay, see the moon in the sky? It's about the size of the cap on my Soul Glad bottle. I just reached out my hand, I could grab the moon, couldn't I?
The moon? You mean the Grand Theater?
Yeah. Look at me. I've been away from home for too long. I must be missing that moon. But it's no big deal. The Grand Theater here looks much better than the moon back home. It's just magnificent. They told me not to sell everything I had just to come to Penacony. How short-sighted.
Selling everything you had? Why would you go to such lengths?
Can't you see? Life back home is miserable. It's not really living at all. It's better to be here at Pinnacone. No pain, no worries about tomorrow, just sweet dreams. You can do whatever you want. That's what I call living. Yeah, now this is the life.
Is this truly living?
Huh? What did you say, young lady? I didn't quite catch that.
Oh, it's nothing, sir. You see, the traffic on Glock's Avenue can be dangerous. How about I ask a Bloodhound family member to escort you to Idine Park over there, so you can continue enjoying your sweet dream?
Oh, yeah, that's a great idea. Wow, no wonder you are the leader of this sweet dream. You're totally a lifesaver. See you around, Mr. Sunday, and it was nice chatting with you.
What's up, sister?
is the land of the dreams. But why do they live like this? The man we ran into, he doesn't seem happy at all. Even though sweet dreams are nice, they're just illusions. But for him, they're the only way to survive, even if it means giving up on reality. That's not really living at all.
I suppose you have a point. But, in my opinion, that's how most people live their lives.
Why do you say that?
You think that man is not actually living, but that's not quite accurate. Even without Penacony, people create their own illusions called self-value. People believe they have a predetermined value to fulfill. Gaining value means gaining power, and those deemed worthless are seen as the weak. However, value doesn't come out of thin air, and there's a limit to it. To accumulate value, people have to take from others. So the weak get exploited and oppressed.
Are you suggesting that this is not how things should be?
Exactly. But, ironically, people don't think there's anything wrong with it, because they uphold the illusory notion of self-value, and even the weak believe in it. The survival of the fittest. That's where all the tragedies in the world come from. People come to the sweet dream in Penacony to escape from that reality and find solace. No tragedies exist here, only happiness, although in its nascent form. Isn't that the same paradise we yearn for in our dreams?
Perhaps that man is just an exception. Let's not jump to conclusions. We should experience the dreamscape ourselves. Just as I did at Dreamflux Reef.
Yes. Seeing is believing. I'll accompany you. The Dream Master hasn't shown up yet, so we have some time for a stroll.